I'm Andrew Williams. I'm with the corporate communications team here at Goldman Sachs, and I'm very excited to have Jason Rezaian here, Washington Post columnist and author of Prisoner. I'd like to join you in welcoming Jason to our stage. Jason, tell us about the night of July 22nd, 2014.
So that was, I had just returned from covering a round of the nuclear negotiations between Iran and world powers in Vienna. The negotiations towards a nuclear deal were really reaching a climax, and this story of engagement with Iran was shifting. And this was my first opportunity to cover it from outside of Iran, from another foreign capital. I returned home. My wife and I were preparing to come to the United States. We'd been married for 15 months. She's born and raised in Iran. I had applied for her U.S. permanent resident status, and that was ready. So we were coming back to the U.S. to take a much-needed break and also pick up her green card. And on the night of July 22nd, we were preparing. Our bags were packed. 48 hours, we were headed to the States. We were getting ready to go to a surprise birthday party for my mother-in-law. And as we left our building and went down into our high-rise's garage, when the elevator doors opened, there were three men standing at the garage door with guns pointed directly at me. They pried their way into the elevator, took us back up into our apartment, claimed that they had a warrant for our arrest. I never saw anything like that. Separated my wife and I, ransacked our apartment, went through all of our belongings, our personal documents, seized our passports, our money, our devices, made us relinquish our passwords, and then very unceremoniously said it's time to go, walked us through the courtyard of our building past our neighbors. I call it the walk of shame, because in that part of the world, people are familiar with this, you know, friends, neighbors, relatives being hauled off to an uncertain fate. We were thrown in the back of a van with tinted windows, blindfolded, handcuffed, and taken off to Evin Prison, which is known as one of the most notorious political prisons in the world. So that's how it started.
And was that, were you put into solitary confinement once you arrived there?
Almost immediately. I went through an initial interrogation blindfolded, where I was told that I was the known head of the CIA station in Tehran, that I'd been working there under the guise of journalism for years, but they knew all along that I was a CIA mastermind.
And what kind of evidence were they presenting you with?
The most crucial piece of evidence, and I don't want to give too much away about this, but was about a ill-fated Kickstarter project. I'd planned to start an avocado farm in Iran. And that, they were sure, was code.
But what was
it? What? They weren't sure. What was the question?
But what was it? What was the avocado farm about?
The avocado farm was just another way of telling the story of this society that's isolated. Iran is a country that is one of the leading agricultural producers in the world. You can grow anything there. The climate is perfect for growing avocados. Why are there no avocados in Iran? Is it because of some sanctions rule? Are they haram? Are they against Islam? I wasn't sure, but I wanted to find out. They thought that this was code for some kind of secret military installation that I was planning to plant in the northern part of Iran, I guess.
And this was something that we'd come, this wasn't just one setting of questions, this was week after week.
This existed in my interrogation from July of 2014 until at least February of the next year.
And what is that solitary confinement? What are you in?
I was kept in a cell that was 4.5 by 8.5 feet. So I could lie down in one direction, but not the other. The ceilings were about 10 feet high. There were two very small windows high up that I couldn't see out. Bars over those. The only thing I could kind of glean was the time of day, whether it was day or night. There were bright fluorescent lights on 24 hours a day. And the big iron gate of my cell had two very small holes, one at eye level where they could open and bark orders at me, and one down below near the ground where they could put food in as if I was a dog. And that's how I spent the first 7 weeks that I was in prison. Mm.
Yeah. And then you had many more days after that, still in prison.
Yeah, I was initially in that first period, and you learn this very quickly, but the solitary confinement is designed to break you and to separate you from reality, to confuse you, and essentially to make you go crazy, to make you malleable to the point that you will say or do just about anything that's asked of you for the reward of some human contact. But I was taken 6 weeks into that ordeal to court, and my some members of my family were able to be at that court date, and they told me that and I know that this wasn't supposed to happen, but they told me that the Washington Post is making a big deal of this one, and that John Kerry has already given two speeches about your plight. Up until that point, my captors had told me that it had been reported that I was killed in a car accident, that nobody cared, and that nothing was happening. So this wall of lies that they built up started to crumble, and I think it didn't necessarily serve any purpose anymore to keep me in solitary. So once that ended, things were looking up after that.
Well, at some point, I mean, throughout the book, I think you do use humor as in your own head as a way of coping. And you were also given access to television, which, surprising to me, had a fair amount of American movies.
Right.
And I think that allowed you in the book to talk a little bit about the soft power of the United States.
I mean, I think, when I came out of solitary, I was put into a cell that had this small TV, and it had the full range of Republic of Iran state networks. And several of these networks were dedicated to films and serial, television shows. And the bulk of the content was Hollywood produced. It was censored. It was stripped down. In Iran, you don't have, it's a society where sex out of marriage is illegal, dating is illegal, alcohol is illegal. So any reference to these things were sort of airbrushed out of the film. I mean, I think about some of the movies that I saw while I was in there, The Big Lebowski. My wife asked me, we had watched it several weeks before we were arrested. She said, how was it possible that they put The Big Lebowski on television? It must have been very short, I said, yeah, it was about 40 minutes long, no white Russians, no smoke and reefer, just a Persian rug and a bowling alley, that was the extent of it. And I mean, lots and lots of movies, but it gave you a glimpse into how they think, right? And in the information vacuum that I was in for all of that time, all I was trying to do was figure out, what does this all mean? And what does it mean to me? And if and when I ever get the hell out of this place, I'm gonna have a great story to tell.
Yeah.
So I better remember some of this stuff.
Well, there's an admonishment, I guess, to all of us in the book that I'd like to read to you, if that's okay. This is the admonishment. I only wish people around the world could wrap their heads around the fact that Iran or the Islamic State or fascists or the Soviets never once posed a threat to our way of life and probably never will. We have the ultimate soft power, Hollywood. And it's one that no matter how hard they try, they can't replicate. They don't know how to be all things to all people the way you do, the way we do. You can't learn that. You either have it or you don't. And for me, that was very powerful. And do you feel like people of this country understand that sort of power? And do they go too quickly to other sorts of power?
I mean, I think it depends on which people we're talking about. But I think the vast majority of us don't recognize, all you have to do is turn on the TV and you'll hear pundits talking about the lack of credibility that we have, the lack of influence, we're the laughingstock of the world, and maybe that's true at some point right now, but that hasn't deterred the vast majority of people around the world to really still look at this place as their ideal. And the ideal that they've conceived of in their mind is the ideal that they saw on screens in their home countries, whether it was in a movie theater or whether it was on a pirated DVD or through an illegal satellite broadcast. I can't tell you how many times young Iranians would ask me, is it really like that? Is it as good as that? And I said, well, it's a little bit more complicated than that. And I have a lot of friends now, people who've immigrated from Iran, who will say to me, we wish that we had listened to you, because we always just assumed that America was perfect. We just thought you were dumb, that you were foolish for picking up and moving over here. And the reality is that we have, what do they say, that we only use 10% of our mental capacity? Is that what they say?
Something like that,
right? I think we only use about 2% of the rights and privileges that are afforded to us by living in this society. And it's a pretty wonderful thing. I mean, I'm looking around, seeing people from all different sorts of backgrounds in this room, and pretty much every room that I encounter in this country. And that's a rarity. Most parts of the world don't operate that way.
But I would think, while it's powerful, at the same time, it's probably fragile.
Sure. And I think, we have to do a lot more to protect it, hone it, and honor it. And, I look at the way, I've been writing a lot since I returned back to work full-time at the Post last year about press freedom issues. And unfortunately, although I think our freedom of expression here in the United States is on fairly solid ground, even though there have been attacks on it in recent years, that's not the case in the rest of the world. And the rest of the world looks to us to sort of be a guiding light on some of these issues. And if we're not going to hold up those ideals, and if our leaders are not going to hold up those ideals, you can't expect fascists and authoritarians to do so in their own countries.
I noticed throughout the book where your captors would use Guantanamo Bay as an example of we're not doing what they're doing there.
Right.
And I think that's a clear example of what you're talking
about. I think that we have to be very careful about double standards. Another thing that I've written about a lot recently is the importance of due process really honoring the rights and privileges, the legal rights and privileges that are afforded to us in the Constitution in all cases, right? I don't believe that there are circumstances where you should throw those regulations out the window. Guantanamo is a perfect example, because we're seeing now around the world that more and more governments are using the pretext of alleged crimes against national security to put people in prison for long periods of time without due process, without trial. Or legal representation.
Well, you've recently written about Lind, the person we call
the American Taliban.
American Taliban.
Or the Marin County Taliban, as we call him.
So he spent,
17 years
in jail.
Yeah, and was released, it was a 20-year sentence, I guess. He was released 3 years early for good behavior, and there's a lot of people who said he shouldn't be released. So, well, you know, he went through a legal process. He committed pretty ridiculously atrocious crimes, treason, by most accounts, but went through a judicial process, paid his debt to society, and we have to honor that. If we don't do that, we're not any better than anybody else.
So we continue to see that journalists are under threat in different parts of the world, mm-hmm. in Iran and other places. Are there things that you felt, I mean, in retrospect, that benefited you? Like, what's the path to helping journalists in similar situations to you?
I honestly believe the best path is to always shine as bright a light on journalists and others who are being unjustly detained or threatened wherever they are in the world. Most governments respond to that kind of public pressure. And I realized, I wouldn't say early in my detention, but not too far along, that the trial that I was going to be subjected to wasn't going to be one that I could win. You know, I was put on trial in a revolutionary court. The success rate for defendants is like less than zero. I asked one of the guys that I was released with, another American who's a former Marine, what the success rate, you know, what the conviction rate was. I said, what is it, like, what do you think, 97%? He said, no, it's well over 100% because some of us get convicted twice, you know? I don't know if that works out math-wise, but... I understood that, you know, my real trial was the trial of public opinion. And the only way, or the best way to win that, is to have as many people around the world talking about you as possible, in as transparent and full detail as they can. And I was fortunate to have worked for a lot of different news organizations, built a lot of relationships before I worked at the Post, and had friends all over the world who were willing to do just that. Mm-hmm. And I think it contributed measurably to my release. But ultimately, I wasn't gonna get released, and a lot of these people, especially if they're US or European nationals, aren't going to get released until their government gets involved. So, you know, there was no hope of me coming home until the Obama administration decided that it was politically important for them to get me out. The same is true right now. There's 6 Americans being held in Iranian prisons, and there is absolutely no real efforts to bring these people home because besides me, there's just very few people doing anything to shine a light on these people's plights.
How does the current relationship between the United States and Iran impact, well, that, and give me a broader, how do you see things today?
Look, I mean, I think you can have whatever opinion you want about the nuclear deal that the Obama administration struck with Iran. And I'm not in a position to defend it or boohoo it any more than it has been. But the fact is, there was a sustained period of contact between our government and their government for the first time in over 30 years. And in a process like that, you're going to gain lots and lots of information about the opposing side. The current administration is not using any of the information that it gleaned. And I think in your business, it'd be very helpful, right? This is one of the largest untapped markets in the world with vast energy resources. I mean, the highest combined oil and natural gas reserves in the world. You know, a country that's young and educated and has a lot of cash and gold reserves. I think that we should be talking to them. Not necessarily making sweeping deals with them, but, you know, definitely not just putting them in the corner facing the wall.
Well, Jason, we wish you and your family the best of luck forward, and we can't thank you enough for being here and sharing with us.
I appreciate y'all being here today. It means a lot to me.
Thanks, everyone.